Get started?
Yep.
We're live. Eric has an announcement.
Your commitment through an abortion.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Not us, says the Lord, the one who created us.
Do not be afraid.
God has called you by name, and you belong to God.
When we pass through danger, God is with us.
The waters will not overwhelm us, the fire will not consume us.
For God is the Creator, the Holy One.
We are precious in God's sight.
Each of us dearly, come worship God, who leads us into life.
Please join me in the opening prayer.
Holy God, of glory and majesty,
we have called us by your name.
Pray for the courage and the strength to answer. As we open our ears to hear you, open our hearts also, that we may experience the renewing power of the Holy Spirit. Inspire us in this time of worship, that we may work to build your kingdom. We pray in the name of our brother and friend, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, I'm doing a live sermon today, so just bear with me. 700 years before Jesus was born, God commissioned his prophet Isaiah. And Isaiah spoke to the people who were coming out of exile in Babylon. And the people were confident. They were very sure that they were doing God's will because they were following the prescribed laws, and there were a lot of laws. Now, our text today touches on fasting. But the community had not learned from their experience in exile. They didn't understand how important it was to live and love justly, to share their wealth with the poor, and to do acts of mercy in the name of the Lord. They were focused on themselves and on their own lives rather than having a meaningful experience with the living Lord. So fasting is definitely a spiritual discipline that is beneficial. As you can tell, I don't do much fasting, but it is a good thing to do. But in this text, God is talking about another kind of fasting. He's asking people to serve him by serving others. So hear what God seeks from us and what God promises if we are obedient. Now listen for the ifs and thens in the scripture. And it's Isaiah 58, 6 through 12. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe them, and do not turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing fingers and the malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves on behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Your people, now this is, I think, the key to this verse. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and raise up the age-old foundations. You will be called repairers of broken walls and restorers of streets with dwellings. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. We give us sometimes God's presence? Are you doing what it takes to become blessed by God in ways beyond our imagination? Do you seek God's face in the faces of the people around you, and then do you serve? Well, centuries after that was written, have things really changed? Do we have more in common with the Israelites than what we want to admit? If we make sacrifices, if we serve, are our actions relatively small, so as not to create too much discomfort for us? I'm going to be asking you a lot of questions today. There's no right or wrong answers, but there are things to think about. Are we today, are we in need of someone like Isaiah? Someone who's bold enough to shout out without holding back the truth? Do we need someone to remind us to do what we know we should really be doing? What are we going to do about it? I believe the first step is to be honest and to examine ourselves as individuals, and also to examine our church collectively as a congregation. Moxham, Johnstown, and our church have changed dramatically in the last 20 years. It's changed dramatically in the last 2 years. We are not the church that we once were, but we are still the body of Christ. We are still the church of Jesus Christ, and we have a job to do. So I'm going to ask these questions, and I want you to think about them. I want you to reflect on them. Maybe this week one of them will pop into your mind and you'll take it to prayer. I hope these questions help us assess where we are, who we are, and where we're going. Do we even know where we're going? So what does it mean to be the church? What does it mean to be the church of Jesus Christ today, in this time, in this place? What are our passions? What are we passionate about? What gets us excited? What invigorates us? How do we use our gifts and our resources? You know, this week we have perfect examples. We gathered in here and talked about the scholarships. That was an uplifting experience. What are our areas of influence? What areas can we influence and change? I'm going to ask you to look around the congregation today. What people do you see here today that are deeply rooted in this church, that you just can't even imagine the church without them? That they're so vital to our ministry. Are there people like that here today? Yeah, I think there are. And then, you know, who's here or not here? They're members, but they're not plugged in. And what can we do to help them be plugged into the ministry, to become vital to this church? Yep. The real question is, what kind of person are you? Are you vital? Or are you just not plugged in, really? You know, you come and you do your basic duty. You come on Sunday morning and you throw some money in the offering plate. And what would it take for you to change from not being plugged in to being vital? What would have to change? What would have to change in you? What would have to change in your surroundings? As a church, where are we going? trust everybody as friends that live in this neighborhood. So how is God calling us to connect? Yeah, this is where we're planted. So you're supposed to grow where you're planted. We cannot pick this church up and move it somewhere. It is here. So how can we grow where we are? You know, and how can we connect with our neighborhood or reconnect to the neighborhood? You know, we had prayed that hopeful relations would be the answer for making that connection with the neighborhood. Unfortunately, that didn't happen the way we had hoped it would. And after 3 years now, we decided it was time to move on. But we need to face the truth about our current reality. And somebody said to me the other day, well, you said we're a dying church. You know, the moment we are born, we begin to die. People, plants, everything. There's death built into our cycles. Now, personally, we can do things to extend our life. And as a church, there are things we can do that will extend our life. But sometimes we're confused. You know, we say we want revival. We want people to come to the church. And we want those who have fallen away to return, come back. And we want to see the church filled like it was 20 years ago. But to do that, we have to change. And we're less certain that we want to change. We want people to come to us and be like us. We don't want to meet people where they are. And that's human nature. That's not Grove Avenue. That's human nature. But the scripture tells us what we have to do if we seek to be revived. We have to serve God by serving others. And God desires, God longs for his people to be revived. He longs for the church to be revived. So what is revival? Sometimes we confuse revival with evangelism. Evangelism is the responsibility of every Christian. And that is you live your life and you serve in such a way that you proclaim the love of Christ to others. That's everybody's responsibility. Revival isn't something we do. It's something the Holy Spirit does. And the Holy Spirit does that by moving among us and within us. So evangelism will not produce revival, but revival by the Holy Spirit will always produce evangelism. Are we ready to rebuild the ancient ruins? Are we ready to raise up the age-old foundations? Do we want to be called repairers of broken walls and restorers of streets with dwellings? Do we want to do that? Or does that just sound like too much work? Does that sound too hard? If we want to be revived, we're going to have to do that. Because God will revive us if we are faithful. And God has called us to loosen the chains of injustice and to set the oppressed free and share our food and provide shelter and clothe the naked. You know, God will show us our faults and our failures. But he will never leave us wallowing in them. He will show us the remedy. He'll show us what we have to do. Drawing us closer to him, encouraging us by telling us how he will bless us if we are obedient, if we serve in his name. And the scripture today said, if you do these things, then your light will break forth like dawn and healing will appear. You will call and I will answer. The Lord will guide you, satisfying your needs. You'll be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. And you will be rebuilding the ancient walls and foundations, and you'll be We can't mark it on the calendar, or we can't anticipate when it's going to happen. Revival is set according to God's will and to His time. But we can prepare ourselves, and we can plead with God to revive us. That's what we should be doing as a church. We need to be praying, Lord, revive us. Breathe new life into us. And those who are revived, they reveal the gracious work of the Spirit through lives that are marked by God's own hand. And those who have been revived, they don't speak about how wonderful they are, how righteous they are. They show that through their lives of service. Their transformed hearts are revealed to others. So like the Israelites, we can kind of sleepwalk and allow ourselves to feel that we have done what God expects. We've done the bare bone minimum. And that's all we have to do. We can check off, we've been in church, we've given our money, whatever. But we can't substitute that for a real relationship with our Lord. You know, I don't know if we're going to have a new world. I don't know if I'm going to ever be alive to see this church packed again. I don't know that. But what I do know is we can grow spiritually. And God is promised not to stay where we are. Doesn't matter if you're 12, almost 13, or if you're 80-some. There's room for you to grow. There's room for you to learn. There's room for you to do different things than what you've done before. But we have to be willing to change and to grow and to serve. And we have to actively be the Church of Jesus Christ. You know, this church isn't here for us. The Church of Jesus Christ is here for the world. So, when I first came to Rogue Avenue, I went to a training session, and I think maybe Eric and Eileen were at that. I don't remember who, but maybe Lois, up at Oakland United Methodist. And Amy Wagner did it, and she said, if you have 15 people in a church, 15 people, that's all, in a church, who are willing to work together, who are willing to tithe, who are willing to change, who are willing to grow spiritually, can set you up for revival. You know, God still has to do the reviving, but it can set you up. She said it's not going to be easy. She said it's an 8 to 10 year process. It's 8 to 10 years. And when you do this, you have to abandon some things you hold dear. And then you're going to have to be willing to learn and unlearn things. I'm just asking, are you up for it? Are you up for it? Or do we want to just continue going the way we've been going? I can do either. You know, I can do either thing. But I would encourage us to seek a vibrant relationship with the living God. God desires us to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And He desires us to make His name known as we serve others. And ask me a question. And you heard my husband probably ask this question many times. What is it, Patty?
Do you know him?
Do you know him? Do you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? I'm going to go one step further. Are you willing to be the church? Are you willing to be the Church of Jesus Christ? You know, if we honor God and not our own desires, if we're willing to serve in His name, I know God will restore us. We need to pray for the revival, but we also need to pray for our strength and courage to step out and to do something different, to become the church in a new way. That's my hope and my dream for Grove Avenue, that we would, and for Homestead, that we would become a church that's willing to step out of our comfort zone and listen to whatever God's calling us to do or to be. That we would care for each other and nurture each other, and then also care for those around us, our neighbors, and nurture them. Lord, make it so. Amen.
Amen.
Scripture reading is from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1 to 7.
7, New International Version. But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead. Since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you, I will give people in exchange for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is the word of God for the people of God. Praise be to God.
God is at work in us, deep inside of us, where the spirit of life longs to bloom. Let go of your resistance and find God lovingly restoring you, cultivating a healthy garden around you. Trust in God, who is leading us into new life. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven, you are loved, you are restored.
In the name of Jesus
Christ, you are loved, you are restored. Glory to God. Amen.
This is the last Sunday I am going to leave this church early. I think I can say that. I will be at Christ Church for their service today, and next week is their last service. So, I thank you for putting up with incoming and going to Facebook. And I am so glad the ones from Facebook are here with us today. And I hope the sound is a little better today than it was last week. So we're praying that we get smarter with this. This week is John Hollis and Ruth Ann Hollis's anniversary. So we want to lift them in prayer.
Hannah's here.
Hannah is here. Yes, that is the joy.
Yes.
And Hans is there.
Hansi.
And Hans is with us today. That's a double.
Double joy.
Double joy.
Yeah.
And your names even start the same. Do we have any other joys? Well, Eric and I believe have. There's Eric. I saw him. They had a good vacation, and Tom filled in for Eric last week, and that was a joy. So we need to thank Tom for his service, and we are glad that Eric and Eileen have come back refreshed. What about concerns of your heart?
Pray for our nation and those in Afghanistan.
Who have what?
Afghanistan.
Oh, Afghanistan. Prayers for our nation and Afghanistan.
Haiti.
And Haiti, the people of Haiti. Other prayer concerns on your heart today?
Prayers for LaBella family.
The prayers for the LaBella family. Their grandmother passed away from COVID. Tom.
Folks in Western North Carolina still have people missing. It was hurricane last week, and 22 was the last count.
Folks in Western North Carolina that have folks missing after the hurricane. Other Hans. Students that are returning to school.
And their teachers.
And their teachers, Deb says. Yes. Is everybody ready to go back to school?
No.
No, Michael says. Oh, you're ready. That's good. Other prayer concerns? Did anything come in from Facebook, Karen? Oh, it's up there.
Not much.
Pablo and Journey are taking Bev back to college. And a joy for your birthday.
Heather and Pablo are taking Bev back to college, so. Yes.
My brother Jim has cancer in the lungs, liver, and spine, and he's in hospice care.
Jim Hollis, Pastor John's brother, has cancer and is in hospice care, so we will keep Jim in our prayers.
And he's bad, and just struggling with it.
And we will continue to keep Ruth Ann in our prayers as she deals with her physical limitations, which are hard to live with. And I'm going to let Pastor Deb pray. And I'm going to Christchurch. So have a blessed week, and I will see you soon.
A chub hits you in the wolves inside my mind. I try to keep you safely in between the lines. I try to board you in the box that I designed. I try to pull you down so we are eye to eye. When did I forget that you always been the king of the world? I tried to take my back right out of the Just a whisper of your voice and take the seat. So who am I to try to take the lead? Still I'm running ahead, I think I'm strong enough. And you're the one who made me from the dust. When did I forget that you always been the king of the world? I try to take life back, but I'm in the hands of the king of the world.
And Lord, with these words on our lips, we come before you this day. we give you thanks also for him. Listen, God, you hear our prayers as we come before you, and we thank you that even now you are working in and through the lives of the people that we've named for you. Hear the ones who are crying with pain in their heart. Hear the ones who are weeping with grief long into the night. Hear the ones who are sobbing in their loneliness. Loving God, heal their pain, restore their lives, and mend their broken hearts. We especially lift up to you, Chuck, and our brothers and sisters at Christ Church, and Phyllis, and Ruth Ann. We remember our brothers and sisters around the world, especially in Haiti and Afghanistan. We lift up our nation, Lord, and all of the men and women who are being deployed into places where they will be put in harm's way. And Lord, we pray for the Lavella family. We pray for the folks who have been affected by hurricane and are still missing. We pray for righteousness go before you, and the glory of the Lord be your rear guard, because God always has your back. May you call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here am I." May your light rise from darkness, and your night become like the new day. May the Lord guide you always. He will satisfy your needs and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. And may you always find your joy in the Lord. And remember, it begins with "I love you," and it ends with "I love you." And Jesus loves you, and I'll do take a little something from your path. You know him? And Pastor Deb loves you.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall